This is Thoughts Become Things. With each episode, we'll help you reach the highest creative potential that God has for you. With your host, a teacher, life coach, a dream coach, and motivational speaker, Jeremy Lopez.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to another podcast of Thoughts Become Things. I'm Jeremy Lopez, and I'm really excited you guys decided to join with me again today, this week. What a powerful week it's been so far. You know, we call Wednesday hump day, you know, which lets me know it doesn't mean that the first half of the week is very busy and the last half of the week is not busy, or the first half of the week is good and the last half of the week is bad. I believe hump day to me means that the first part is good and the second part even gets better. Because I believe that we go from glory to glory. We go from good to greater. And I think that it happens that way for those who truly believe it can happen that way. And those who put the key words I'm going to give you today in the podcast, and once you include these key words, it will begin to get better for you. So I do believe we go from good to greater in our lives. And once again, I want us to sort of define some things for a moment. You know, when we're talking about success, a lot of times people get sort of antsy when we deal with success, especially Christian people, because a lot of Christian people look at that and say, oh man, you're one of those prosperity gospel preachers, or we're talking about success. That's worldly. Let me tell you something. Success can be whatever you want it to be. A person who looks at the word success and says, that's a worldly, you know, term, you know what? To you, it's worldly. The Bible makes it very plain that, you know, to the pure, all things are pure. To the defiled, all things are defiled. So whatever you call it is what's going to be to you. If you think money is evil, money is going to be evil to you. If you look and think the word success is worldly or no good to us as Christians, then you know what? It's not going to work for you, period. But if you know the terminology is powerful only because of what you define it and only because what you put behind it, then you understand that you are a co-creator. See, it's those who don't understand the principles of God that understand the mind of Christ in us lets us know that we have the power to define and redefine and to call those things that be not as though they were into our lives. Those are truly sons and daughters of God. Now, children to me tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine are people who really get caught up in terminology, who get caught up on certain words and certain this and certain that because they don't understand the power that lies within them. And folks, if I could relate one thing to you through all my years of ministry, that would be this. You have great access of power inside of you. You need to access, tap into nothing outside of you, but everything that is within inside of you. You have the power within you to change your world. Now, when I say change your world, I don't mean just change the nations. I mean, first and foremost, folks, you have to change your own world. You know, Gandhi once said something very powerful. He says, be the change you want to be in the earth. Isn't that just pretty much scripture? Because you got to be what it is you're trying to implement within the earth. If you can't be what it is you need to be, first of all, but what you're trying to see in the earth, then you're not going to make a change at all. You've got to be that change. You've got to be what it is that your vision is telling you, you know, that you want for the earth. Because if you don't have a vision for yourself first, you can never have a vision for anything else or anyone else. If you yourself can't make it, how on earth do you think you're going to teach other people to make it? If you're not victorious, how on earth do you think you're going to teach other people to be victorious? It's the same principle as people always saying, you know, if I want to get in shape, for example, I'm going to go to the gym. I want to be able to hear from someone who actually is in shape. And no offense, folks, once again, grace is given to all of us, but it's human nature for us to look at people with examples. In fact, if you want to get technical and biblical about it, that's what the Bible tells us. The Bible lets us know right off the bat that, you know what? It says, if you really basically want to know they're my disciples, know the love they have for one another, which means there's action that is put into motion. That's how you can tell if it's true love or not. You know, look at their fruit. If they're bearing forth fruit, if someone's not bearing forth fruit, in other words, what is in a man comes out of a man. If something is not outwardly expressed by what is inwardly burning in you, then something's wrong. It's truly not burning in you. So you're going to have to look at the fruit. So what do we do when we want to get in shape? We want to go to the gym. We want to find somebody who is, you know, got abs and who's worked out and who's in shape and fit. They're the ones we want to listen to, correct? Because we know they have paid the price. We can see the fruit on their body, for lack of better words. So knowing that, we've got to realize everyone in creation is going to go after the person who is successful in that genre. And truthfully, we should. We shouldn't listen to people that actually are not successful trying to teach us on success. We should not listen to people who are trying to teach us to get money when they themselves are barely struggling to pay their power bill. You're going to go to people who it works for them. When I deal with the law of attraction, I tell people all the time, it works for me. I have proof. I have materialistic proof. I have proof soulishly. I have proof naturally. I have the proof. I can tell you the principles because I know they work. There's a difference when someone telling you, you know, something works, but yet it's not working for them. Here's what I tell people. When it deals with faith, faith might be the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, but eventually that in which is not seen has to be manifest into the seen realm. So true faith tells me to believe in something that is not there, but the manifestation of the result of what faith will do for you tells me I have to eventually see it. And so you have to begin to come to the place where if you're listening to the people always teaching by faith, but their faith is never making them whole. In other words, if their faith, isn't that what Jesus said? Your faith has made you whole. So in other words, he told the woman, he said, you have true, genuine faith. You know how to access the power to true faith because your faith just manifested in your reality and made you whole. So that's what he's saying. And so is it common for us to listen to people that really don't know what they're talking about because there's no manifestation, there's no connection from spirit to natural? You know what? We do it all the time, and yet that's why we turn out unsuccessful. And once again, whatever success looks like to you, if success looks like a billionaire or an entrepreneur or someone who makes great investments and has profits to show for it, then you know what? That's their success. They've named that as their success. If someone looks at the word success and says, I'm a powerful dad, I'm a powerful spouse, my powerful husband, my family, the nucleus of my family is all healthy, I'm able to protect them, get them to the desired places they need to go, provide food for them on the table, then that's success for them. Then they are a successful father and a successful husband. So success can be whatever it is you want it to be. Success can be when you have a strong anointing. Maybe you don't have a lot in the natural, but you have a strong anointing that breaks the yokes off people, and you have proof. You have doctor's reports of people who said, look, man, I had cancer. I no longer have it. And it literally is caused by this person that laid hands on me. You know, if you have a strong anointing and that's your success, then you know what? You're just as equal as the next person that has an outward manifestation of that expression of faith. And so therefore for them, it's going to be success for them as well. So success can be defined or redefined of whatever it is you want it to be. Now we first of all, before I give you some points today that are very simplistic in nature, but I want you to hear me out when I say these to you. But before I do, I want you to understand that through our lives, that sounds great to have soulish success. That sounds great to have natural success. But once again, if the Bible makes it very clear, and if the Bible is true, then we know that I wish above all things you'd prosper and be in good health even as your soul prospers. There has to be a balance of success, whatever you want to call it, that actually is manifesting in the unseen realm and manifesting in the seen realm. So success has to be in the soul and the body. It really should be a combination of both. So if you are great in your achievement soulishly, and you've got it all together, and you know every scripture down pat, and yet you are powerful with revelation, with prophecy, whatever, but yet naturally you are suffering financially. You are barely, you know, making ends meet here. Then you know what? You're not balanced. There's not truly an outpouring of what we call real success, because success truly needs to be defined or redefined by its expansion. And so first of all, you have to bring the word success into a greater awareness and a greater level of expansion. So success should be according to scriptures, and faith should be according to scriptures, and abundance of life should be according to scriptures, because once again, we know scripture says what? Even as your soul prospers. So it goes from naturally to the soul. And so it lets you know that these things, faith, success, anointing, favor, whatever it is, should be in every single area of your life. The full totality of who you are should mimic that word success of however it is you defined it. So if you say, I am successful in my endeavors of finances, I am successful by being an entrepreneur, I am successful in my investments, then you know what? All that tends to be natural. That's great. No problem. And truthfully, we should have more of those people in the earth. And so if that's the case, then you should actually also move into what I call the spiritual wealth movement, which spiritual wealth actually means spiritually and soulishly, are you matching that same vibration of success that you are manifesting in the natural as well? If not, then you have done well in the sense of defining your success and making it a place of victory in your natural being. But you have not taken the word success and truly expanded it to a greater capacity and a greater degree of how God is really truly wanting it according to the kingdom way of thinking by manifesting it in the soul now. And there's something that's called a spiritual wealth movement today. And I love it. I'm a part of it. I dive into it. I swallow it up. Spiritual wealth movement means that you've got to begin to be soulishly wealthy, because everything that needs to happen in the natural must first happen within the soul. The soul and the spirit must prosper to a strong level in order for it to truly pour out upon you in the natural. Now, most people don't know how to do that. Most people do not understand the techniques, nor do they even understand it should outpour from their soul, so they have no clue how to do it. And then a lot of people actually does not really understand the power of what it means when we say spiritual wealth. Well, what is spiritual wealth? Can't buy me a car. I beg to differ. Spiritual wealth is actually what truly buys you a car, not natural wealth. Spiritual wealth lets us know automatically that what is in a man will automatically come out of a man. That which is first has to be inside of the heart. In other words, it has to come from the depths of the heart, because out of your belly, out of your soul, out of your spirit, out from your innermost being flows rivers of living water. If you want a flow to come naturally, you're going to have the flow that starts in the pool of your heart, where you're building it up by understanding that my soul must prosper first before the natural aspects of me prospers. Now, when you understand that, you are going to be able to know the expansion of success and faith of what it truly should be. Faith has to be in the unseen realm first in order for it to manifest on the seen realm. That's what true faith is. Now, you might say, well, that doesn't work for me. Then you have wishful thinking. You don't have faith, you have wishful thinking. Wishful thinking lets us know that I'm thinking it's faith, but it's not really faith, because if it's true faith, it will automatically, eventually pour out of me to manifest where I can see it, touch it, and tangibly know it is real, and other people can see it. But when it's in a cocoon state inside of me, if it's true faith, then only I will see it, but it will begin to grow in me like a virus until I cannot longer contain it any longer. Now, when we're looking at wishful thinking can also, if you're not careful, can be called faith, but it's not going to be true faith. Wishful thinking never has ever manifested in reality, ever. You can wish all day long, but wishes and wishful thinking actually never manifest, period. It's like I can dream all day long. I can daydream all day long about things, but if I'm not putting action to what is the true foundation of what I call dreaming or wishful thinking, which has to be faith, then it's never going to prosper, ever. So I have to have the foundation of faith in order for me to move from that. Now, when I have a true level of faith, then I should dream about that manifestation coming from faith coming into my world. If I'm truly moving in faith, then I can still have some wishful thinking, even though we're not like that terminology. We can still have wishful thinking because my foundation is built on faith, and faith is the initiator that pushes it forward to make it happen in my my world. And so to me, wishful thinking and dreaming is just pondering on it, thinking about it, letting it go over and over again in your mind. But if the foundation is true faith, it's going to happen. If it's not true faith, it's not going to manifest, period, in your life. So the points I want to make today to you, I said all that to say this, the points I want to make to you today hopefully will jettison you into a new arena, okay? And they're two simple words that equal something else. And I want you to listen to me real closely. And that is, first of all, passion. Passion is a driver. Passion will automatically be forceful with you to make a decision and to push you or push the thought or push the foundation of your desire out into the real world. And what I mean by this is what? Passion is likened unto creativity, because passion means you will push it forward. If I don't have passion, nothing's going to happen for me. Passion is a great force inside of me that is unseen, that pushes me to go forward, that pushes the thought in me to force it, to drive me to action, to manifest. That's what it does. Passion is a force that pushes me and makes me reevaluate and makes me rethink and makes me think about it all the time of what it is I want to desire. And it forces me to constantly keep it, not in my subconscious, but in my conscious mind, in my now moment, until it begins to manifest eventually. So passion is what is my driver. Passion pushes me and forces me to think, to put action behind it. Now, when we're dealing with passion, people ask me all the time in life coaching, well, I just need to know what God has for me. Prophesy to me. You know, tell me what God has for me. I said, not going to do that. That's not how the kingdom of God works. I'll give you, if God gives me some stuff, I'll give it to you, absolutely. But that's not how the kingdom of God works. The kingdom of God works when you begin to build yourself up in your most holy faith. The kingdom of God works when you push your baby forward. In the natural, when a woman has a baby, she's going to push. She doesn't say, oh God, make this thing happen. Make this thing go away. It doesn't work that way. The woman has to push it forward. And when you push something forward, then you know what? It's going to come out. Anything you push is going to go forward. And so if you think about it from a push and pull standpoint, if I push something, it's going to come out. If I pull something, it's going to come closer to me. And the choice is up to me, not God. God has already given me all things that pertain to this life and to godliness. Put it another way. God has already given me all things pertaining to this world, this natural being, this natural existence of mine, and the things that are in my brain, in my soul, and in my spirit. So because of that, I truly have the power to balance it out in both arenas. I truly have the power to push what I need to be pushed out of me and to pull, put another way, attract into my life what I need to attract in me. And guess what? I've already got the keys to do that. I've got the knowledge, the know-how, and the wisdom. All I have to do is tap into the power and the source within me. And I can do it. So without passion, you'll never make life happen. Never. You can say, oh, I'm looking around side to side. I can't find anything. Then you don't have passion. Passion will drive you. It will literally drive you crazy, in a good way, until you begin to see what lies before you. Now, when we're dealing with passion, what is 1 + 1 = 2? So one of the things I want to tell you today is passion. The other thing I want to tell you about is purpose. When people say, I don't have a purpose, I don't know my purpose, I don't know where to go. Sure you do. I love what Tony Robbins once said, which is really true. It's in you. It's just because you're not hungry enough, desperate enough to want to see a move. That's why it doesn't happen for you. You don't have anything in your life, which is so true. You don't have anything in your life because you are not pushing it forward. You're not passionate enough, and you're not pushing forth your purpose. Now, once again, you might say, well, I don't know my purpose, Jeremy. Yes, you really do. When you're desperate enough, you'll find your purpose. Trust me on that one. When you are desperate enough and hungry enough, your purpose shows up. I've always realized in my life that when you are desperate to be taught, the teacher shows up. When you're desperate to teach, guess what? Students show up. When you're desperate and passionate enough for an anointing, a fresh anointing, you'll get a fresh anointing. When you are passionate and desperate enough, now there's a difference between being passionate and desperate and being someone who actually has low self-esteem but just would like to try something new. Big difference. When you're passionate enough and you know your purpose, and now you might say, well, then Jeremy, how on earth, if you think I'm just going to push it forward, where am I going to look for my purpose? It's all around you. Purpose is all around you. See, here's where people miss it. So many people are looking for their purpose in a faraway land. So many people are looking for the purpose in some, you know, sweet by and by mentality of, you know, 10 years later, you know, from where I am right now, it's pushed in the future. That's not how purpose is found. Purpose is right beside you. It's in you. It's right beside you. And it's pulling and pushing every moment of every day in your life. And how you find it is open your eyes. Here's what I'm going to tell you. This should set many of you free. Open your eyes and look around you to see what you're touching, what you're ministering to, what is being changed, what is being drawn to you, what is being pushed from you. You know, is not your person, your purpose. But where's your effectiveness in your life? If you're being affected by helping other people, by fixing the cars, there's your purpose. If you find yourself where everything around you is being lifted up because you're constantly speaking life into it, there's your purpose. You're an exhorter. You know, you're probably a teacher. You're able to help encourage people and exhort them and motivate them. You could be a motivational speaker. You know, whatever it is that is around you, you're affecting right now. I mean, the only way you would not be affecting anything, folks, is if you're dead. But every one of you, well, I don't have a family. I don't have friends. I don't get out much. Well, then guess what? That's your, you know, no offense, but getting out much is your problem. Not having a family might be something you can create. Are you with me? Not having friends is something you can create. So truthfully, folks, it is your own problem. Now, I don't mean that in a bad way, because I have complete compassion on people. But here's the thing. Even a person, I've known people who their families were killed in car wrecks. And as bad as it broke my heart to say, oh my gosh, I could not imagine having my wife and kids or my husband and kids killed in a car crash or a plane crash. I couldn't imagine. Not just one of them, but all of them. And I've known many people in my life who have had that happen to them, either their spouse or their kids or both. And you know what they did? They waited a couple years later and they said, I'm not going to stop living. I've got to live. I'm tired of surviving. My heart has been broken, but I have the power to fix my heart. And how I can do that is I can, yes, keep the memories of my loved ones who've passed on, but I've got to fight. I'm hungry enough and desperate enough to fight to live the rest of my life in victory and be happy. I deserve happiness. I deserve joy. And people, you do. Every one of us deserves the power and the right of joy and to be loved and to give love away. But what's stopping you is nothing more than yourself. Not some devil, nothing. What's stopping you is you. You were made in the image and likeness of God. God created you in His image and likeness to begin to go forward and make great accomplishments and make achievements. You can do it. And I've known many people who actually that's happened to. And you know what they did? They didn't let life stop them. They eventually recreated their life. They recreated. How they recreated? They began eventually beginning to started dating again. They began to date again, to get married again. They had more children, or either they adopted children. Folks, you can do what is necessary in your life. You have the power to do what is necessary in your life to do. Don't find yourself being a victim. Don't find yourself barely holding on. Make that victim mentality leave. Send it back to hell where it belongs. And begin to realize this one thing. I like this. I heard this morning. It's true. You know, you can be called a victim just one time. And then after that, you know what? You're longer called a victim. After that one time you've been called a victim, after that, it's called your fault. You might say, oh, wow, Jeremy, that's harsh. No, it's not. Listen to me now. You learn from your mistakes. You learn from your mistakes. You're given grace to learn from your mistake. After that, then guess what? You have to realize you could be possibly attracting it and creating it back into your world because you did not learn from the first mistake. Now, once again, we're not talking about the death situation. I'm talking about now mistakes. If you are a victim in your life and someone has done something wrong to you, learn from that. Let it empower you and move on, because the second time it happens to you, it's going to be your fault. Do you hear what I'm saying? Listen to me closely, folks. You can be called a victim one time, but after that, you should learn from your mistakes and move on. A woman who stays, no offense, women, but a woman who stays with a man who beats on her, you're called a victim the first time. The second time around, guess what? It's gonna be your fault. It's on your hands. You've got to learn to say enough is enough. When you're hungry and desperate enough to say enough is enough, I am tired of living my life the way I'm living. I am tired of being a victim. I'm tired of finding myself at a place where I have a woe is me mentality. I got to move on from the situation. And when you begin to move on, good for you. Then you know what? You're going to be retitled as a champion. Because you deserve to live a successful, happy, joyful life. And you've been given one life to live. So in this life, find your passion. Find your passion and run with it. And find your purpose. Your purpose is all around you. And your purpose could be that fact that maybe you once was a victim. And when you became a victim that one time, I always tell people this one thing, and that is this. If you hit me, you only have one chance to hit me. Because after that, you will never have that chance again. Are you with me? I have one chance in my life to be poor. After that, I'm never going to be poor again. I have one opportunity in my life to be able to learn, to make a mistake in every single genre of my life. After I've made a mistake one time in every single genre of my life, then guess what? It'll never happen to me again. Why? Because I am an avid learner. I want to learn from my mistakes, and the moment I have a mistake in certain areas, I'm not going to be perfect, but I'm going to learn from it, and it'll never happen to me again. Why? Because I've destined it will never happen to me again. Why? And you know how I can back that up by the kingdom? Because I've learned through my problem. I've learned through my mistake. I've learned through my tragedy. I've learned through my victim mentality. I've learned through my horrible things that I didn't ask for, or things that I didn't mean to do, or things that I didn't even have a part of, and it just happened to me. But after that one time in my life, or your life that happens, you know what? You pick yourself up, you learn from it, you empower yourself with a victory by empowering yourself from the education and the knowledge and the wisdom of what that happened to you, and you move on and you determine and you make a determination in yourself, this will never happen to me ever again, says me. And the moment you do, guess what? You decree a thing, it's established, and guess what? You go forward. But you got to build up passion in certain areas of your life to see it change. And when you begin to build up passion, and you begin to purposefully find in your life what it is that you're called to do by watching what is around you. I know I got on several topics today, but I felt the need from the Lord to tell you these things. But if you find your purpose around you by seeing what is victorious and seeing what you're doing that is making differences in your life, then guess what? You know your purpose then. Run into that purpose. Build it up. You know, bring credibility to it by expanding it and feeding into it, and watch it metamorphosize into something great and spectacular. The number one thing within people today that are successful is they took the opportunity to see that one thing that we're passionate about, and they ran with it, and it morphed into something else, and then it morphed into something else again. And before long, they had industries, companies, overnight. You know why? Because they learned, if I can just put my passion in one area that I see as perfect, purpose is my purpose, because I see the fact that I'm successful at one thing, or it's changing lives, then what happens is it begins to grow in their life. And when it begins to grow in their life, guess what? You begin to see the power, and you begin to see your life change, and victory is on its way to you. So I want to encourage you today, you know, and I want you to hear me good by the Spirit of God, that I want to encourage you that no matter what you've been through, no matter whatever happens to you, if it's something, once again, that, you know what, you could be the sweetest lady on earth, you could be the nicest man on earth, and folks, women are not the only ones that are physically beaten, men are too, and whether it's physically, verbally, or whatever, or maybe, once again, someone was killed in a car crash, or maybe you lost your job, or maybe, you know, you find yourself at a place where you're not the brightest or smartest person on earth. Let me tell you something, let all of these things only happen to you one time. Whether things were intentionally done or non-intentionally done or accidentally done, or you didn't even have your hand in it to have happened in your life, or whether you did have your hand in it in your life, it doesn't matter. Let everything in your life only happen one time. And then after that, say that it was one too many, because I am going to grow, learn, and educate myself through my damage, through my insecurities, through my victim mentality, through the accident that happened with my family, through this or through that, or through me, you know, losing my job. You know, I don't encourage people to stay put on the whys of why did I lose my job. But I would encourage you to do this. If you find yourself feeling rejected or abandoned by one person, two people, a job, or many people, Take a good hard look at yourself and change your world. Change your world. Find out why I was fired. And you know what you could do? Is here's what I encourage people to do this. If you did get fired from a job and you don't know why, go to your manager, go to your boss and say, hey, look, you know what? No hard feelings. I'm not angry. I'm not going to come in here and shoot the place up. You know, unfortunately, we have to say that nowadays because it happens. You know, I'm not here to come back and cuss you out. I'm here to learn. And I got fired, obviously, for a reason. Can you tell me maybe some things I can work on of why I got fired so I will be able to not make that same mistake twice in another future job? Folks, let me tell you something. Managers, corporations, and companies would honor people that did that. That's called maturity. I'll tell you what's immaturity is when we find ourselves saying, I got fired and I'm so mad at that company, and now we bad mouth the company to everyone. But folks, people don't fire people just for no reason. Unfortunately, sometimes that can happen. But for the majority of times, you get fired because you messed up on your job. Take responsibility. It's okay. We've all been there, done that. Give yourself grace and just learn to say, you know, learn from your mistakes and go on and say, can you just tell me so I can learn? I'm an avid learner. I want to know exactly what I did so I won't take that same mistake with me again. I want that curse gone. Do you know what answers curses? Is education. Do you know what answers curses? Is wisdom. Because you automatically know how to change that. People, so many people today are looking at their lives and they're saying to themselves, well, you know, well, I've got diabetes. It's a curse. It's a curse from the devil. You know, it's in, you know, and this and this and this. And I would recommend this to you. I would say, you know what? Some things are hereditary. Yes. But when you educate yourself to know, could it be for another reason? Maybe I am overweight. Maybe it's something I'm eating. Maybe it's something that I'm not doing properly. Make sure you go through the channels of, the proper channels of educating yourself to know exactly more about that, to where you'll realize, is it maybe a curse? Is it something of the devil? Or most of the time, whatever, no matter what it is in our lives, most of the time it's only because of a lack of education, a lack of wisdom to know, how can I eradicate this in my life? What can I do to deal with this and walk through this and work it all out? And that way you'll begin to be empowered. So I want to encourage you today, take the word passion, take the word purpose, put passion behind your purpose, and there you'll have your mission. And when you have your mission, you'll find your life will be powerful throughout history. So I want to thank you so much again for listening and tuning into this podcast. I am here for you today, folks. No matter what you've ever been through, what you're going through, what happened to you, I am here for you. I want to encourage you. If you want to set up a life coaching session, I am here to set up a life coaching session for you. I'm here to help you pull out what is inside of you, to make you see the highest version that God created you to be about yourself, to learn to love yourself. You can't love other people if you don't love yourself, and you'll never attract the good things of God's kingdom into your life until you learn to love the thing in which is the attractor, which is yourself. And so I want to help you today. If you want to set up a life coaching session with me, then let's go for it. Just call the office at 205-362-7133. That's 205-362-7133. And when you call, just say, I would like to set up a scheduled appointment for 30 minutes, life coaching session with Jeremy Lopez. And my secretary will be more than happy to take your payment, set it up for you, and we'll get you on the books, and you're going to have a victorious 30 minutes of your time. So God bless you, and thank you again for tuning into our podcast.
This has been the Thoughts Become Things podcast with Jeremy Lopez, helping you reach your highest creative potential that God has for you. For more episodes, products, and information on Jeremy, visit www.identitynetwork.net.